Yo, what's cracking, guys? How we doing, Thade?
Morning. How are you?
I'm doing so well, man. Thanks so much for stopping by. You know, we're excited to talk to you, man. We've been looking forward to this for a while. Andrew, how we living?
Good. Just waking up. Give me that alpha.
Yeah, the West Coast folks, we appreciate you guys, man. I know it's early for you out there.
Yeah, I haven't been up this early in a while.
Oh, man, dude, especially the crypto degens, you know, you guys go to bed at like 4 a.m. in the morning. So I know that this is particularly
exactly.
But look, man, we appreciate you being here. You know, if you wouldn't mind just providing a little brief introduction, you know, we've been watching you guys for a while. I know Andrew is a Primeapes member. You know, maybe just tell us more about Primeapes. And, you know, I know you have your gated Discord and you guys are Arbitrum natives and all that. So we'd just love to hear your take.
Yeah, so I'm Thade. I started off in crypto in 2021, so I'm fairly new to it still. It was like April 2021. I found out about Doge just from social media, and I realized my friend actually told me about it earlier that year. I think like before the beginning of the year, and it was under 1 cent. So then it intrigued me. I found out about Ethereum, and late May, June 2021, I got into NFT trading. And then that's pretty much where I got my start with everything. I got really lucky in 2021 with NFTs. That's where I started. And then in 2022, I got more into DeFi once NFT started dying down. And then started Primeapes on Arbitrum. I found out about Arbitrum because of GMX, and of course I heard about it from Small Brains back, I think like winter of 2021, they started popping off. They went to like a 5 ETH floor at one point, I think. So after NFT started dying in 2022, I got more into DeFi, and I started Primeapes. I started the server in, I think it was November of 2022, and then we minted in December. So yeah, we're Primeapes collection is on Arbitrum. We're pretty much a token gated alpha group on Discord. We offer a bunch of tools. We have a bunch of active callers and traders, and meme coin callers and whatnot. But more importantly, we just have an active community that likes to share their thoughts, contribute, and share alpha.
100%, man. A lot of alpha originates on that Arbitrum degen community. And, you know, you're not just an NFT guy. You're a triple threat. You know, you got a builder, trader, collector. Much respect, man. Just crushing it out here. And then, you know, just keep diving into Primeapes here. You know, it's kind of a community of DeFi ores. You know, what narratives are you most excited about right now? Like, you know, where should folks be focusing our attention while the market is still somewhat quiet?
Obviously, the biggest narratives right now are like with LSDs, ETH LSDs, and meme coins. Like right now, it's like the Telegram bot narrative right now. I think it's good to stay up to date, like on Twitter, especially with the narratives. And also, don't be afraid to take profits. I think these narratives, they go by so quickly. But right now, definitely pay attention to meme coins is where all the fun is at right now. I think DeFi is taking a back seat other than like these new LST coins popping up. But yeah, I mean, as far as like the LSTs, there isn't really much money to be made from the tokens that are launching. I think like right now, obviously they're made to stake your Ethereum or stake your other liquid staking token like RAT or staked ETH. But yeah, like the tokens that are launching, they're either being farmed or pretty much just a governance token. So right now, I think it's best thing to do right now is play the meme coins and just take profits if you're up.
Good take for sure. And, you know, speaking of meme coins, you know, crypto is truly a unique market. You know, we see things like Harry Potter, Sonic, Obama, 10 Inu, and a hamster products absolutely moon. You know, what's kind of your advice to traders and to new people entering this space on how to navigate an industry full of degens?
I think it's definitely try to get into different groups like Primeapes, or I recommend Fungi Alpha. I'm in there as well. There's another Telegram group that I'm in. It's called Defiance Crypto Colony, I think. But yeah, try to make friends, stay active on Twitter. I think like if you're just getting into crypto, I don't think you should be messing with shitcoins off the bat. I think you need to learn how to navigate, understand what you're doing before you jump in. But yeah, try like test the waters on all the new dApps and just try to get into these different groups that'll help you.
Yeah, man, I just can't imagine telling your financial advisor that, you know, you were tired off projects like these. You know, I'm just kind of curious, like, what signals do you kind of see from these wilder projects that you keep an eye out for the future? Like, you know, outside of the catchy name, like Harry Potter, you know, Sonic, Obama, 10 Inu just hit $100 million market cap, right? Like, that's kind of crazy. So is there anything particular that you keep a lookout for these more degen projects?
Me personally, I mean, I don't really indulge in meme coins like that. I buy like the odd one here and there just because if I see it a lot on Twitter, if I see it being mentioned a lot in my groups, it's probably a good idea to throw a little bit in. But I know that there are some groups that offer like tools that will send an alert whenever a new token goes live, or say this token goes live and it meets all their criteria, like LP is locked, it's not a honeypot, stuff like that. There are groups that will send those alerts, so people will ape in a small amount, then like in a few hours they'll probably have like a 50x or something. So there are definitely tools out there. I personally don't utilize them to like gamble on meme coins.
Yeah, 100%. There's definitely plenty of folks who do that for us, man, for sure. And, you know, again, just continuing the signal conversation, you know, traders are kind of always looking for signals, but, you know, many are kind of meaningless or even red herrings. You know, what kind of signals like actually like move markets, like based on your experience, that, you know, people should be actually paying attention to?
Yeah, I think right now, like it's Twitter pretty much. If you see a big account, like they tweet something, I think most people follow. Like a 50,000 follower account can probably move a small cap, like, anywhere under like 20 million probably. That's why I utilize Twitter the most. And then obviously the groups that I'm in, they mention different stuff.
Yeah, 100%, man. Like, I know you guys mentioned Fungi Alpha. You know, it's kind of interesting. There's been a few people that have mentioned them before as a resource for Alpha. So, you know, they're definitely doing something right. And, you know, I kind of want to also ask you about your community of well-informed Shads. You know, everybody's building Alpha groups and everybody's saying that they have the best Alpha. But how did you cultivate such a well-informed community of DGens? You know, like, what kind of, maybe even share, like, beyond Fungi Alpha, like, what kind of resources are you guys kind of consuming to stay ahead of the curve, you know, to you know, stay ahead? Yeah.
Yeah. With my group, when I started the server, I just posted on Twitter, is anybody looking to join in Alpha Discord? I just started one up, and then I didn't expect as many people to ask for an invite as they did. So, like, after one day, I think I had sent out like 400 invites or 400 to 500 invites, and had a few hundred people in this server after one day. So yeah, I pretty much just reached out on Twitter, and then the people, I just try to stay active as possible in there and provide useful, you know, insights for myself. And people kind of just stuck around and they provide their own insights. And I honestly didn't even know, like, I had so many, like, big accounts and well-respected people in there. Like, goes from Calf. I don't know if you guys know who Calf is. He's a pretty big caller on Twitter. I have Degen Sensei in there, just to name a couple of them. There's actually a bunch of people in there that are still active. I think most of them, they just follow, a lot of them, they follow like Degen wallets, or obviously they're active on Twitter, always searching. They use like Arkham or AlphaScan to look for Degen wallets and look at what they're buying. And we actually have a wallet tracker tool set up in the Discord, and we're tracking a bunch of different a bunch of wallets right now that are pretty much just participating in meme coin season and all the bots. But yeah, that's how we keep up to date, is just sharing what we see inside the server. And then we also have tools to try to help facilitate what's going on in the market.
Love them, and just kind of
Alan, I'll give you a little more alpha. So I think part of why Primeapes and Fungi were so successful, and I think also attracted my attention, was, you know, an Arbitrum, obviously the home of a lot of innovative DeFi, innovative projects, innovative builders. And I think, like, props to Thade, no one was really connecting everyone together in these communities. And so I think for him, when he put the signal out, you know, there were a lot of folks, you know, researchers, threaders, things like that, that just wanted to come together. And I think that's part of why you see some of these, you know, giant names that he's mentioning in there. So so props to Thade for bringing the team together.
Hell yeah, Thade, you're like Iron Man bringing the Avengers together. So we like to see. And kind of diving a little deeper on the tools here, you mentioned AlphaScan. You know, we just actually had them on the show like last week or the week before. You know, what's kind of your experience with that tool? And, you know, is there any other tools that you can name drop for people to maybe investigate on their own?
yeah, I mean, me personally, I have to be honest, I haven't really used AlphaScan. I've been on the website, but I don't think I had access to it when I went on there. I have used Arcum to, like, try to link wallets and see, you know, try to find potential big accounts and what their wallet might be so we can try to track them. But I do think definitely if you have access, it could be a good tool. A lot of good alpha is shared on there. Like, see what new projects are coming up and see what's being mentioned by these different accounts. But me personally, I don't really use the tools. I just, like, at the moment, I don't really have time to be searching through the tools. I'm very busy. But yeah, I know a lot of people use AlphaScan and Arcum just to try to track people's wallets down for Arcum. And then also AlphaScan, I know it can be a good tool to see what people are talking about.
100%. Always good to have some tools in the back pocket. And, you know, kind of want to continue on the Primeapes conversation here. You know, you guys started a research collective, you know, Eureka. You know, what is the goal with this collective, and what was kind of the trigger to get this rolling?
Yeah, so with Eureka, I have a group of researchers in Primeapes DAO. They write up alpha reports on different protocols. We try to find new protocols or new projects and give a brief explanation if there isn't that much information on them, or they don't have a lot of, there are too many followers and whatnot. We try to give a brief report on the new project. And what we've been doing is with some of the treasury funds, we are farming on GND protocol on Arbitrum. So we're farming those rewards. And then at the end of each month, we sell the rewards and we pay them out to the researchers per each piece of content that they put out for the month. So with Eureka, what I wanted to do is, like, the research arm of Primeapes DAO. It's just like a rebrand for the group of researchers. I think the reason why I started it is because I think it would be easier to like market and promote the research under a brand that is easier to recognize. Well, I think like Primeapes is easy to recognize, but I don't know if people would go to Primeapes Twitter or Primeapes website for research. So that's why I made Eureka. I think the branding would help with the research a lot.
Love that, man. You know, definitely crushing, seeing some serious alpha come from there. And you know, everybody kind of says, you know, DYOR, do your own research. But, you know, what does good research actually look like? You know, like what actually like counts for as research in your book?
Oh, man, I think really digging through the docs and giving like an in-depth report. I think one of my researchers' name is 0xEvix. He's a really good researcher, man. He really dives deep into the docs, maybe like 20 to 30 tweet threads on each report that he's doing. The reports really go in-depth, and he like adds his own flavors, but like he draws maps on how the protocol works. But yeah, just really diving into the docs, going through their tweets and seeing what they're saying on Twitter, and getting in their Discord or Telegram channels and asking questions or even reaching out to a team member and, you know, getting like doing a brief interview to try to understand what's going on with their protocol. So that way you can give the best report that you possibly can. For me personally, I've been doing a lot of the early DeFi projects on Eureka. So whenever I find something, if they have if they have a website and docs, I'll, you know, just briefly skim through the docs and just write a quick report. And mainly what I want to do is give my thoughts on if you can possibly make money using their protocol or possibly make money from a token. That's pretty much what I care about. Yeah, just to answer your question, just try to dive in deeper and get as much information as you can so that way you can provide a good report to people.
Love that, man. Yeah, that's definitely a question that, you know, we had. And you mentioned connecting with team members. You know, it can be kind of hard getting in touch with some of these people. Like, what's the best way you found to actually get in contact with some of these folks? Is it Twitter DM? Is it email? Is it LinkedIn? Is it carrier pigeon? Like, what have you kind of found that, like, actually works for you?
Oh, yeah. So, for me personally, I like to reach out on Twitter. I think the people that I've reached out to so far, they know of Primeapes DAO, so it's pretty easy for me. I think if you can get into their DMs and just let them know that, hey, I'm a researcher, I would like to get more info. If you have free time, I would like to set up a call or, you know, have a quick chat through DM to see if I can get more info on your project and that you're writing a report and whatnot. Other than that, you could probably hop in their Discord and set up a support. I know a lot of servers have support tickets. Try to let them know that you are a researcher and you're just trying to get more information. I think a lot of the teams are willing to respond. I know probably like a lot of smaller accounts, they probably do get ignored. But if you just let them know like, hey, I'm a researcher and I'm writing up an article, or I'm doing whatever this piece of content for you guys, I'd appreciate if I can get more information on your protocol. If you have time for a chat, let me know. I think they'll be willing to respond. But yeah, so for me, it's Twitter and Discord definitely are the places to reach out.
Love that, man. Definitely good alpha right there. You know, it can be tricky to find, get an actual response these days. So love to hear that. And, you know, I kind of want to, you know, we mentioned trading bots a little earlier. You know, I saw Eureka mention trading bots in the weekly DeFi rabbit hole series. Now, do you kind of foresee Telegram and Discord bots being a big meta this next bull market?
Yeah, man. I was actually thinking about Unibot I think last week or something. And they have like a real chance to be like the main trading hub, like through Telegram. Like you could be out on your day, you pull up Telegram or you pull up Unibot X. I think they have their own app at this point, or they will have their own app. You just pull up their app and they have all these analytics, all these different tokens that are launching. You have a position manager. I really think like Telegram bots are going to be bigger than we think, or they're definitely bigger than they are right now. Like new people coming into crypto, they don't necessarily have to set up their own wallet. They just do it with a click of a button on Telegram, send your ETH or send however much money to this address, and you can literally just start trading with Telegram. So I think they're going to be huge, especially going into a bull run. I'm actually coping on Unibot pretty hard because I just checked, it's like $160, and after being told to buy it at like $2 and then seeing it go up to $4. I'm like, no, it's already up 2x. And then next time I check, it's like $12. And then they relaunch and it goes to 20. And I just had so many opportunities to buy, but I was like waiting for a dip that never came, I guess. But yeah, I think Unibot and Telegram bots are definitely going to be a lot bigger than they are right now.
Yeah, I mean, that's definitely a fair take. I think you're right on that. And, you know, kind of maybe talking about Unibot a little bit more, like there's so many bots out there. You know, what makes Unibot, you know, different than the other ones? And also maybe why should traders even use bots? Like, you know, they might not understand the value. So if you could break that down, that'd be awesome.
Yeah, so for me, when I started like looking into like the Telegram Discord bots, is when we started working on ApeGPT. It's pretty much like Maestro or Unibot, but it's in our Discord server. I didn't know about Maestro or any of these other Telegram bots. I actually with the meme coin aping bots. I actually, the first one that I saw was from Consortium Key. Sorry, one second. Consortium Key is another NFT gated community. They have a bot, I think it's called Phoebe. It's pretty much like Maestro, and they also send alerts on new tokens, I believe. And so that's what we wanted to build with ApeGPT in our Discord and have it token gated. And then when I found out about Maestro and it was free, and like I see all of their like revenue from fees, and I was just amazed. So I think what Unibot offers differently is obviously it's comparable to Maestro. I think they have like like 0.1% smaller fee, so it's not really a big deal in terms of fees. But I think what they did well was the referral codes. They got people to show their referral code. More people start using Unibot. And then, of course, the token made it a lot bigger, especially with the revenue share. I'm kind of going off track here. I forgot what the question was. You just wanted me to talk about Unibot more, right?
Yeah, man. That was definitely the first part. And then, you know, it's like, you know, you kind of answered the rest, like foreseeing if the Discord and Telegram bots are going to be a big meta this next bull. And, you know, that follow-up question was, why should traders be using these bots? Like, what is the significance of that, right? Like, a lot of new traders might not understand why they should be maybe taking a look at these.
Okay, yeah. So for me personally, I think Uniswap is very hard to use, and that's where most of the these tokens are launching. It's not really hard to use. It's just a pain because a lot of the times for me, when I'm trying to swap in and out of a token on Uniswap, I get a failed transaction, or it just simply an error doesn't go through. With these Telegram bots, they actually, I think they optimize it so that way it chooses the best way for the transaction to go through. You can have it so that it automatically sets the slippage and the gas for your transaction to go through. And I think it just takes away the friction from doing it yourself. Like, you can just put in a contract address and literally just press a buy button or a sell button in the Telegram app, and it will literally do it for you. I think it takes away a lot of the hassle of doing it yourself. And then also with different communities that have these bots integrated in their server, you see people, like, what they're posting. Or at least in my server, I don't know how it works on Telegram servers. You can see people, look at the tokens that they're posting. Like with ApeGPT, it pulls up a report. And then you can literally just buy or sell from inside the Discord. I think the main reason for people to look into these bots is take away the hassle of doing it yourself on like Uniswap and whatnot.
Yeah, man, especially some of these bots are, you know, meshing with AI. So it's going to be scary. You know, some of these things might actually printing, you know, for you. So just definitely keep an eye on that. What are your kind of thoughts on that? Like, is the upside of, you know, this AI integration with these bots, like, going to be kind of insane?
Yeah, I think with AI, I mean, I'm not sure exactly how, like, AI works, to be honest. I haven't really set up a bot to with AI, but I think there's going to be these different bots that can probably like scan a contract for you, and if it looks good, they'll probably be able to buy the coin for you, like when it launches, and most likely be bots that can snipe launches just based off an AI algorithm or whatever. I think definitely it's going to be. We're probably going to see some crazy upgrades to these bots in the future.
All about those entries and exits, baby. Dang, AI might be helping us with that. That's what we like to hear. Right. All right. I guess I'm going to ask you as well. about layer twos, you know, how are the opportunities on layer twos different from, you know, ETH and alt ones? Like, you know, can you maybe break that down? What should traders and DGens understand about the layer two ecosystem?
Yes, I mean, layer twos, they're, you know, trying to help Ethereum scale. Obviously, I think, especially in a bull run, and like in 2021, 2022, when gas fees go up to like 50 to all the way up to $200 just to do a swap. I remember when my first meme coin I bought, I think it was like Kishu Inu or something. And I just wanted to buy $100 worth of it. And I ended up, no, I wanted to buy $200, but I only got $100 worth because I had to spend $100 on gas. So ETH L2s will definitely help with gas fees and bringing more people over. So in a bull run, especially when gas fees are going crazy, I definitely think we're going to start seeing more activity on L2s. Right now, it's pretty dry, to be honest. I'm looking forward to the launch of Base and hopefully brings more opportunities over there. I think looking into Mantle is a good idea, because I think they're going to start their incentive soon. But yeah, other than those, I can't really think of any other L2s that I'm looking at personally. But yeah, whenever, you know, gas fees get higher and there's a lot more activity, I definitely think L2s are going to be the place to be. Right now, you can start looking into the projects that are going to be launching on them and try to get in early. I know, like, React's Finance on Mantle, you can actually deposit. This isn't financial advice, by the way, but you can deposit on there and start farming their soon-to-be token. So yeah, good opportunities like that. Just try to get in early and look for farming opportunities where they're rewarding in their token. So that way, when they launch, you pretty much have like free money.
That's an alpha right there for you for sure. And, you know, gas fees absolutely can be a pain. You know, maybe people forget what it was like in the bowl, but, you know, there was some fat transaction fees that you were paying on ETH. And I kind of want to ask you, you mentioned Base. You know, what makes you excited about Base? What do you kind of see there as, you know, upside, you know?
Yeah, I mean, obviously it's backed by Coinbase. So I think, you know, they should bring a lot of new players to the space. I think there's going to be, obviously there's going to be more opportunities when the mainnet launches. There's going to be more protocols and different projects launching, more meme coins to ape and try to get in and out as soon as possible. But yeah, with any new chain that launches, I think there's going to be new opportunities, but I think Base has a chance to stick around, obviously, because they're backed by Coinbase, and obviously they're going to be pushing Base and try to get as much people over there as possible. So yeah, just look out for new opportunities on all these new L2s that are launching.
Love that, man. Let's maybe hope for some new customers coming into the space. It'd be awesome. And I kind of want to ask you about TVL too. Do you kind of think TVL is a signal, or is it kind of too manipulated to be taken too seriously?
I think if a new chain launches and it's not really hyped and they are gaining like organic TVL, I think you should definitely look into it and see what's going on over there. I know like for Arbitrum, maybe at the beginning, when they first started talking about a potential airdrop, it might have attracted a lot of TVL, but obviously the projects on Arbitrum and the different DeFi protocols made the TVL stick. So it could be these different chains, they have like incentives and the TVL goes up. And then once those incentives go down, you know, so does the TVL. But Arbitrum was good because of all the innovation and all the different DeFi protocols that are launching. It made the TVL stick. Like me personally, I keep most of my funds on Arbitrum just because that's most of the projects that are launching is my interest is on Arbitrum. And then also after using pretty much that solely for the past year, I think, or going on a year and a half, I honestly hate transacting on ETH. Even if I have this, even like a $5 to $10 gas fee, I hate it compared to like a 5 or 10 cent gas fee.
Completely understandable, man. I mean, to be honest, gas fees aren't even, you know, feasible for people to, you know, use in many countries, right? So like they're too high to even use the chain. So definitely something that you got to be looking at. Kind of want to, you know, dive into back into Primeapes. You know, I saw you guys partner with a VC firm. You know, what has your experience working with VCs been like so far, and where do you think most of the investments will be focused in 2024 and beyond?
Sorry, forgive me 1 second.
Nice. Just you and me, Andrew. We're holding down the fort.
I'm in an Uber right now.
Andrew, you know the last time I mentioned Uber or crypto and Uber, what happened? The guy started chilling XRP. That was hilarious. This guy had like a whole presentation on his phone that he hooked up through the Bluetooth system, you know, and turned the speakers all the way up.
So the good news is I'm not being shilled hex at the moment, so I'm feeling good in my Uber.
Guys, if you ever want to adventure, just mention crypto when you're riding in an Uber. There's a 1,000% chance that the driver is going to be invested and going to want will have a coin to shill you. So you know that's some alpha for you if you guys are looking for some entertainment, especially on those long Uber rides to the airport and whatnot. But yeah, this has been a good space so far. I mean, look, Thade, you're back. Okay, yeah. Gotcha. What's up?
Sorry, someone's at my door. Where was I with the question?
Oh, no worries, man. So I just asked you, like, you know, Primeapes recently partnered with the VC firm. You know, what has your experience, you know, been like working with VC so far, and where do you kind of see mostly investments going to be in 2024 and beyond?
Yeah, I mean, it's a good experience so far. They're very responsive, and we've only partnered with one, and I've only been in contact with one firm. So can't complain about any. Can't complain about the experience I've had with them. So we partnered with them a few weeks ago. We pretty much just have access to a bunch of seed rounds that I would say normal people wouldn't have access to. These seed rounds normally are, you know, their valuation is anywhere from like 20 million to 200 million. So a lot of them are already, some of them are already pretty high, but these are like legitimate businesses that are, you know, trying to raise a lot of capital and have, you know, these extensive roadmaps and everything planned out. And then a couple of the ones that we've raised for, they actually have their products live and they are already generating revenue. So in like, I think one of them has, I think almost 2 billion in assets under management or something. So yeah, I mean, with Primeapes Capital, we pretty much post the opportunities that the VC gives us, and then we gauge interest with the group, and if there's enough interest, we'll start doing a raise. And I think so far we've between three or four different raises, I think we've raised close to, yeah, three raises, we raised close to 150K so far. So it's turning out well. I think if more people are, if you're interested in like longer term investments and you are okay with putting money to the side for, I don't know, maybe anywhere from like a year to 2 years, I think it's definitely worth getting a Primeape or even 10 key nanas, so that way you can have access to these seed rounds. And besides the VC seed rounds, we're also offered like smaller startup DeFi protocols that offering us private sales as well if you're interested in, you know, a potential bigger return. So that's our experience with the VC so far. It's been really good.
Bro, that's such a dope opportunity. Definitely would recommend people check that out if that's up your interest, because I don't know a lot of people offering that opportunity right now. And, you know, kind of follow-up question there, you know, the companies that you guys are seeing, you know, there are tons of crypto startups launching right now. Like, how do they kind of end up on your radar? Like, I know you talked about assets under management and revenue generation, but are there any other signals that you look at for like, hey, like this might be a good one to invest in?
Yeah, I mean, other than the VC deals, because those are, they actually do a lot of the due diligence for us, and they provide a report and their opinions, and they sit down with the team. So other than that, like for our private deals, what I would look for is if they're reaching out to me, I kind of want to get more info on the team first and foremost, and see what they've done, if they've done any projects before. Look at the docs, and if it's, you know, if it's just a simple copy and paste, or if it's not really, there's no innovation, probably pass on it. So yeah, I think the most important part is to, you know, look at the docs and also try to vet the team and make sure that they're not a rug. You don't want people, or you don't want to send your group's money to them and then they just run away with the money, you know, or they launch and they stop like working on the product or the project pretty much, and then the token just goes to zero. So you definitely want to work with and try to get products with good teams.
Yeah, 100%, man. And, you know, just, I guess I have thought of another follow-up question just when you were talking there, you know, like what kind of country or what countries or region are you seeing most of the crypto innovation, you know, coming from? Is there one that jumps out to you?
I don't know, to be honest. I haven't really asked like where these devs are from, to be honest. I think, well, like in the ones that have docs teams, I see a lot of developers from Asian countries. And then also from U.S., from what I can tell. And then there might be some countries because they're, you know, like last names I don't really recognize. But yeah, I haven't really asked where these developers are from, to be honest.
Gotcha, yeah. Just, you know, time is of the essence in this market. So, yeah, I don't want to be hours behind the call. So, yeah, you know, I'll set my time zone to whatever time zone the alpha is coming from and just live that lifestyle, man. Just DM me. Let me know. I'll be all over that. Yeah. Anyway, kind of NFTs. you know, the NFT market seems to be close to the bottom. You know, how should kind of investors approach the NFT market moving forward for the remainder of the year and, you know, kind of moving on in the future as well?
Oh, man. So coming from me personally, coming from NFTs, I personally think NFTs have been pretty stale and for the most part dead for like the good part of a year. Right now, I'm thinking about like what NFT projects can do. And other than dilution, like obviously it worked in 2021, but there isn't much that NFT projects can do to directly benefit their holders. I don't think a lot of them can provide like revenue share, like with a token, the way a token can, just due to legal stuff. So I think it looks like it may have bottom, but I don't think we see another NFT run until crypto starts going towards all time highs again, and influencers and like celebrities start talking about NFTs and crypto again. Because right now it's just so PvP. People are pretty much trading ETH with each other, and then after a week or a month, there's just people left holding a bag. So yeah, with NFTs, I personally don't think we see another bull run for like maybe another year or two with NFTs. Like we need to get celebrities and people making a ton of money off NFTs again to get new people to start trading. So my take on NFTs right now.
No, definitely fair. I mean, do you kind of see us maybe pivoting more toward like a collector meta, you know, maybe like, you know, real world assets backed by NFTs, tickets, you know, NFTs, like, is it going to be less of the PFP picture and more of the, like this blockchain technology, how it's actually going to be used in the real world?
Yeah, definitely. I think that's what NFTs, like their main use case will be, is stuff like that. And for the PFPs, I don't think right now, especially, they're really going to get any better than they are, or they or any better than they have been. But with like tickets and whatnot, and NFTs that represent something physically, I definitely think that's what the big use case of them is. And also, utility NFTs that grant access to something like a Discord, or grant access like some kind of membership to a group or whatnot, or like a tool, a gated tool. I think that's what that's what NFTs should be used for right now. I think that's where most of the value is coming from.
Yeah, we also got to rebrand, man. Got to change the name. You know, NFTs are they're not flying with the public. You know, maybe digital collectibles. something else, but you say NFTs and the normies look at you weird. So I also want to ask you here about DAOs. You know, a lot of the DAO hype has cooled off. You know, how do you see DAOs developing over time sustainably, and where do you kind of see Primeapes at the end of next cycle and beyond?
Yeah, I think with DAOs, they need to try their best to get people to participate in governance. Like, I know sometimes the market could get boring and people, you know, just kind of forget if they're not really keeping up. So with me personally, I think our most recent proposal, I think I put it has to get at least 50 votes in order to pass or take action. And we only got like 20 something votes out of 1,007 primates. So it's, especially right now, it's kind of hard because people aren't really paying attention. It's kind of slow in the market. With DAOs, it's pretty tough. With primates, I think you have to have 3 primates in order to create a proposal, but I'm really the only one doing the proposal. So I don't know. I don't want to say incentivize activity in the DAO, but there needs to be, in order for DAOs to grow, they need to, I think people want to feel incentivized to participate, I think. So for Primeapes 2023, we have a group called the Primeape Cartel. We also like manage the treasury, so that way we can, you know, try to get a running business and help pay the our contributors and our alpha callers and whatnot. And like I see 100s in the space in the audience. He's one of our traders in Primeapes, so we're trying our best to try to incentivize our different alpha callers. And our, I also see Glitch in there, who's the developer for ApeGPT. We want to try to get our contributors paid. I don't know. It's kind of tough because for me personally, I do have a group and we manage the treasury. So we don't always make proposals, just for, you know, to save time. And also, made it clear that, you know, this group is going to manage the treasury, but we'll also, if you have a proposal, or if we're going to spend a lot of money from the treasury, we'll create a proposal. I think right now it's just slow for DAOs.
Yeah, definitely, man. Definitely seen a little of the hype cool off, but you know, the ones that are still here, the ones that are still grinding, you know, they're actually doing some significant things. So, definitely ones to keep an eye on for sure.
I have to say, by the way, I agree with you, Thade. I think the governance piece is so important for so many protocols, and I don't think people realize the impact of this and how that voting and those proposals can actually benefit you as an individual member. So, little alpha friends, we're about to hit that ourselves.
little alpha leak. I like it. I guess the next question I have for you, Thade, is there anything that you think is overhyped right now in terms of crypto or blockchain sectors? You know, is there any FUD that you have to share with us?
Overhyped. Besides all of the different Telegram bots that are coming out right now, because a lot of them are just, you know, copy paste. A lot of them are just trading bots that all do the same thing. So other than that, I'd have to say probably LSTs, to be honest. For the hype that they're getting, I mean, I don't have like a big bag of ETH where I could just stake my ETH and live off of the interest, you know, or get enough in interest or get enough in yield to be happy with my return. So I think for most of us, I would say we aren't even staking our ETH or utilizing these unless you want to, you know, do a degen, borrow stable coins off of your ETH really quick to try to make a play. For me personally, I would have to say LSDs are pretty overhyped for me personally.
Definitely good take, man. With the Telegram bot, that shiny object syndrome, you know, it's got Twitter pretty good for sure. A new name, and that thing suddenly going to go to $100 million market cap. Apparently, kind of wild. I kind of want to ask you also. We're seeing like serious TradFi entities like BlackRock, publicly supported digital assets. Now, do you kind of envision we might be closer to mass adoption than many might believe?
Yeah, I hope so. I've seen a few people that think we're going to be hitting in an all-time high towards the end of the year or beginning of next year, which I'm hopeful for, just mainly because of, you know, potential adoption. With like BlackRock coming in, I really think if you think about it, like there's going to be a lot of new investors buying Bitcoin at least through them. So hopefully it, you know, starts a new bull run. I think it's important like for people right now to try to continue stacking ETH and Bitcoin. Keep trying. If you're trading these low caps or these new meme coins, continue trying to stack your ETH using your gains from these new coins coming out, because I think whenever this new bull run comes, or you know, the ETH and Bitcoin start going crazy, it'll definitely, you know, be worthwhile, and definitely try to take profits when they've hit a certain, say like 70% or something. If you're up 70% on something, definitely try to take profits, you know, don't be afraid. And if you think like it's going to keep going up, it probably will, but everything will, you know, come back down eventually.
Yeah, I can't forget it to take profits, man. A lot of people forgot about that part last cycle. You know, I kind of want to ask you also, you know, are you expecting some kind of a turbo bull run given TradFi's involvement? You know, is there anything we should look out for, you know, that, you know, to protect the bags, you know, anything like that that comes to your mind?
Yeah, I mean, I'm hopeful. I mean, I don't really have a background in economics or whatever, or, you know, trading and stuff like that. I'm just a degen, man. I started with NFTs and now I'm looking at these low cap DeFi protocols. But I definitely do think there will be like another crazy bull run. I'm not sure when it's going to come. But I will definitely be prepared to be taking profits, you know, like, that's rule number one. Right now, I think it's a good time to be accumulating, the good coins. Like I think, Ethereum, Bitcoin, obviously. I think Solana might have another narrative, because I think DeFi on Solana, their TVL is going up a lot. So that might be something to look into. Like I said, Unibot, I think, is going to be a good hold, just because what they're building, it's pretty bullish. I think they're going to be able to attract a lot of normies, the way it's so easy to trade on there. Yeah, just look out for good protocols that are, you know, generating revenue. I think GMX is going to be a good hold going into a bull run, and try to cut the bags that aren't really, you know, getting any real revenue from their protocol.
Yeah, well said for sure. Look, man, I know we're coming up somewhat close to time, so we just got a couple more questions here for you, and we'll let you get on your way. I know you probably have a busy day ahead. You know, just kind of want to ask you, you know, you're in that trading circle. What kind of recurring patterns or traits have you noticed about the traders in your community that successfully perform year after year versus just one bull market cycle?
Yeah, in terms of, like, trading with, like, leverage or perps or whatever, what I've noticed is they really dig in deep with the technical analysis. That's something that I personally don't do. They, you know, and they stick to their stop losses and take profits. With me personally, when I started like trading on GMX, I would set they actually don't have an option to actually set a stop loss. So I would set a mental stop loss, and I would just never close my position. I would rather get liquidated than close my position at a loss. So I'm definitely not a good trader. So it's good to follow these different traders that really show results and provide good technical analysis. But for, like, I buy coins spot, and if they have a narrative or an upcoming catalyst for it to pump, then I'll sell going into the pump. So what I look for is pretty much on Twitter, see what people are talking about, and if I see like a potential catalyst in the project for the token to pump, I'll try to buy and make a quick return on it. Like, for instance, there is actually a meme coin called Pepe AI that just launched today. I saw someone tweet about their NFT. They minted last month, I think, for 0.35 ETH. And when I bought the NFT, it was one ETH floor. And they actually launched their token today. And if you claim the tokens, you would burn the NFT. And I think it was like a 7x or 10x from mint price. So there's just keep an eye out on Twitter and see what people are buying and mentioning. And that would be the, it's definitely my recommendation.
There's always opportunities out there, man, you know, especially in this market. You know, I guess the last question we have for you is, you know, what's next, you know, for you and Primeapes, rest of 2023, what will you be focused on? Do you have any predictions on where things will be by the end of the year, you know? But just the last signing off question, like, you know, what can we expect for, you know, I know you touched on it earlier, but maybe just dive a little deeper.
Oh, yeah. So hopefully at the end of 23, my prediction is we're definitely going to be at higher prices than we are right now. So I think it's a good idea to continue accumulating. For Primeapes, we're working on ApeGPT. We want to, first of all, make sure that the product is up to par with the other bots and everything is working properly. And we have, you know, some different mechanisms that we're putting in place, like stop loss, take profits, and some other cool degen strategies that we can implement with the bot. We want to put it in a public beta. So we're going to be reaching out to different communities and seeing if they're interested in putting our bot into their Discord server. Because right now, with these alpha communities on Discord, if they don't have a bot in there, which I can't think of many communities that do have a trading bot in their Discord, they get some of these communities, they offer like alpha pings whenever they think like there's a good token to ape. And then their users or their community members are taking that contract address from Discord, opening up Telegram, pasting it in Telegram, then buying from like Maestro or something. So if we can get ApeGPT in their server, it'll just be easier for them. So that way they can just have everything in their server and their community members can utilize the bot from inside of that server. So there's ApeGPT that we're working on. It's probably going to be going into a public beta within the next like 2 weeks. We want to continue growing Eureka. Hopefully eventually we'll be able to reach out to other researchers that are interested in joining and posting their content through Eureka. The way, like, as we grow and continue making revenue from the DAO, we'll be able to continue paying our researchers. But yeah, other than that, we're just reaching out and talking to different protocols, trying to get some alpha private sale opportunities. Yeah, that's pretty much it. So, I mean, if anybody in the audience has a community that might be interested in implementing ApeGPT in your server, just reach out and let us know. We'll definitely consider it.
Love that, man. Look, you guys are building out here, doing a lot of cool stuff. We appreciate your time. I know you're extremely busy, but look, Thade, you know, we're excited to see what you guys do in the future as well. Andrew, any final words before we wrap? Going once. Andrew might be in an Uber, guys, so let's just let him do his thing. Hey, look, man, we appreciate you, you know, obviously looking forward to see what you guys do in the future, and you know, we'll catch you on the timeline for sure.
Yeah, thanks for having me, guys. Thanks to the audience for listening as well.
Absolutely, we always appreciate the listeners. All right, everyone, every Thursday, Base Genomics, we talk to awesome people like Thade. Stop by 12:00 p.m. EST. Much love, everybody. Weekend's almost here. Enjoy. Talk soon.
Yeah, have a good one.